This week, the United States records its 7 millionth COVID-19 case and its 200,000th death. The virus is once again spreading throughout Europe and even gaining a new foothold in certain US states, as epidemiologists urge the American public to brace themselves for the fall and winter months. Plus, why Wall Street is calling some of their employees back to the office while other industries are telling their staff to stay home through next summer. And finally, Tesla investors were left disappointed after Elon Musk's much-hyped Battery Day event. I'm MacKenzie Sigalos, and this is CNBC After Hours. Wall Street closes the day in the green, but it's not enough to keep the Dow and S&P from posting their fourth negative week in a row. The NASDAQ composite is the outperformer this time, as investors scooped up big tech names like Apple, Nvidia, and Amazon after these same stocks saw a steep sell-off earlier this month. And we saw another development on Wall Street this week. Bosses want employees back at their desks. JP Morgan asked its senior management to return to the office this week. And according to the New York Times, Bank of America and Citi have plans to bring portions of their staffs back in October. Now, while the finance industry is hurrying to dust off their stock trading terminals, other sectors aren't in such a rush. Tech giants Facebook and Google have told their employees that they're good to stay at home until at least summer 2021. Twitter is giving its staff the option to work from home permanently. And $30 billion payment startup Stripe is actually paying people to move farther away from office headquarters. So why is Wall Street different? CNBC.com banking reporter Hugh Son explains.
It's somewhat surprising that they're rushing back. In some ways, it is surprising because Wall Street has had blockbuster results so far this year. The first half of the year will probably go down as the best start to a year for trading in the past decade. So when you look at that and you know that most of that has occurred while people are sitting at home, the socialization aspect of Wall Street has always been that you would turn around to your senior, or if you were a manager, you turn around to your junior and you'd bark out commands or you'd ask questions. How do I deal with this? I've never seen this before. What do you think about this? And so the socialization aspect can't be discounted. And part of the culture of Wall Street is for them to sort of indoctrinate these first year analysts in the culture of Wall Street, in the culture of the specific firm. And the fact that they are concerned about this class, and they're concerned about perhaps the experience of this class and the quality of this class, is one reason that they're doing that. The other reason is, you know, Jamie Dimon hasn't been shy about this. He said that, you know, according to the way they measure things, the performance of some of their people has actually been falling down, and specifically, the performance has been degrading on Mondays and Fridays. It's undeniable that there's an aspect of Wall Street that has that machismo, right? That has a sense of, if you don't come in, you're weak or you're afraid. If you look specifically at JP Morgan, which is sort of the tip of the spear in terms of coming back, you know, they actually specifically called anybody with management over teams, and they called them in to come back, you know, this week, which is September 21st. You know, in my mind, when I saw that, even though I was told that people below management level aren't supposed to be coming in, the first thing I thought of, well, is, you know, if my manager comes in, does he secretly want me to show up? And is there going to be social pressure? And will my rival on my team be there physically and therefore have a leg up when it comes time to determine bonuses? In terms of the nuance of this is that even when people come back, there are probably people who will be working 5 days a week from the office. But for the most part, they're going to be coming back in rotations. They're not going to have 100% of the people in the office anyway. Social distancing guidelines are going to require at most 40 or 50%. That they're going to be in a better place if they have, at the very least, some of their people and some of their senior managers in the office.
And now let's get to our sound check. Here's a timeline of This Week in Business told in just a few sound bites.
You'll have a Judiciary Committee hearing sometime likely in October, which unfortunately is probably going to be like the Kavanaugh hearing on steroids. And then depending on, you know, the public perception and polling of that, we'll either have a vote before the election or we'll have a vote probably right after the election.
I it just doesn't make any sense to me at all. And, you know, they've got to get China's approval here, too, to allow the algorithm to go out. I just don't understand. Look, they said they were going to do one thing. This is not that. And it's still, it almost creates a more porous situation, it seems to me, with all these different owners and who's on the board. It's just feels so back scratchy.
This is deeply concerning. I mean, seeing these kinds of activities where guidance gets drafted somewhere else and posted on the CDC website, and that those kinds of things are very concerning, because you need to be able to accept that the material being put out by an organization, by an agency, represents the view of that agency.
The whole thing is a crock. I mean, it starts, obviously, simply to say we want to protect the security of Americans from anything that could happen to them by using TikTok. It is now morphed into this kind of ludicrous kind of game match between tossing ownership here, control there, et cetera, et cetera.
We learned that a single dose of the vaccine could give protection very quickly, within 15 days, and with that could be very useful in the emergency use.
People ask us about competition, and our competition is people who just think the old way still works. People who think that insurance card in their pocket is all they need. And it turns out that it's not. And you know, look, insurance is paying for less and less, and prices keep going up for everything.
The recovery we've had so far owes in significant degree to the CARES Act and the support that Congress and provided in conjunction with the administration. And I think while the economy has been doing better than expected, I think there's downside risk to that if there is no further fiscal support.
Another stimulus would achieve speeding up that recovery potentially, or ensuring that recovery takes place. And there's two aspects, the pure economic question, but also the human question. How do we help the people most affected by this virus, through no fault of their own, make it to the other side of the river and cross the bridge like a lot of the economy has crossed?
Is another extension of the payroll support program, is it a bridge to nowhere or is it a bridge to somewhere? And I passionately feel it's a bridge to somewhere. I do believe as we get into 21, the industry will significantly recover.
We are anticipating a deficit in this current fiscal year in excess of $2 billion. This aid is critically needed.
The second wave of coronavirus infection has arrived in Europe. The UK and France have both reported their highest numbers of daily new COVID-19 cases since the pandemic began. The UK even reversed the lifting of lockdown restrictions as they try to tamp down on the spread of the virus. Pubs will now close at 10 p.m., fines for not wearing masks were increased, and the public was urged to work from home whenever possible. Prime Minister Boris Johnson said these new measures could last as long as 6 months. The European outbreak coincides with rising case counts in multiple U.S. states, as well as a tragic milestone for Americans. In the United States, more than 7 million people have tested positive for COVID-19, and more than 200,000 people have died. Death at this scale is unfathomable, but experts say these numbers will only grow larger. This week, the summer officially ended, and autumn has begun, promising lower temperatures, less outdoor activity, and of course, the onset of cold and flu season. As the country braces for the coming months, CNBC Digital asked two epidemiologists what we should expect as the summer ends and the pandemic rages on.
Coronavirus is making a comeback in Europe, even after months of social distancing measures to curb the spread. Italy reported 1,786 cases on Thursday, the UK, 6,644. And other European countries are seeing a spike in new COVID cases too.
Spain and France have both recorded their highest case numbers in the last week as well. As a matter of fact, the level of cases in Spain is akin to the United States having 85,000 cases in a single day. That's how high it is there. And for France, it's akin to us having 65,000 cases in a single day.
Case numbers are rising in the US as well. Over the past week, COVID-19 cases surged in 22 U.S. states, according to data from the COVID tracking project analyzed by Axios. The Midwest saw the biggest increase, but it's worth noting that testing jumped 22% over that same time period. This higher case count comes as the country braces for cold and flu season, which epidemiologists say will bring conditions that make it easier for the virus to spread.
Now, as we go into the fall, we are seeing a lot of these factors that are coming into play that probably are increasing the opportunities for transmission. As schools are reopening, as people are spending more time indoors because the weather conditions are colder and they're in closer proximity in indoor spaces, as the conditions of the weather itself may be actually facilitating the transmission of the virus more efficiently.
The U.S. is still seeing devastatingly high numbers of cases across the country, 7 million in total. And the country just crossed 200,000 deaths just this week. Experts are turning to past pandemics for an idea of what a true second wave would look like here.
The second wave of the 1918 pandemic was more severe than the first, and I expect the second wave of the coronavirus to be more severe this time around because of the fall season. And there is a potential role that school children play in sort of being a catalyst, an engine of influenza epidemiology. Direct comparisons do have their pitfalls because this is coronavirus, not flu.
And there are concerns about the economic effects as well. There are already fears that Europe is facing a double-dip recession as lockdown measures are reenacted. Wall Street investment firm Bernstein warned clients on Thursday that the U.S. is likely to see a true second wave of coronavirus, much like the one happening in Europe now. Bernstein said that U.S. markets could, quote, take some pain again in the coming months. However, experts don't think it's likely that we'll see any future lockdown measures as severe as the ones in March and April.
I do not believe that we're going to reach back to certainly a national stay-at-home order or even sort of pervasive lockdowns or stay-at-home orders. I think the mitigation this time around is going to be a lot more targeted. You might see certain cities taking stringent steps when they have dense epidemics.
Epidemiologists say the same measures used throughout the year can help limit a second wave: masks, hand sanitizer, and social distancing.
Okay, let's get to our numbers round. First up is $2,500. Google will help staffers pay back their student loans by matching up to $2,500 per employee per year, according to an internal email reviewed by CNBC. Now, the goal of the new benefit is to help younger generations save the extra money and be able to purchase homes or start families sooner than they would otherwise. The program is scheduled to roll out in 2021. Next, $41.2 billion. Special Purpose Acquisition Companies, or SPACs in Wall Street jargon, have raised $41.2 billion so far in 2020. Now, that's way more than the $13.5 billion that they raised in all of 2019. SPACs, which are also called blank check companies, are a current IPO trend for startups looking to go public. Basically, all the money is raised up front, and then the shell company goes out and buys another company, therefore taking it public. But they're currently under regulatory scrutiny. The SEC chairman told CNBC this week that his agency is focusing in on the usually very high compensation structure for the sponsors who run these things. And finally, $25,000. Tesla CEO Elon Musk announced that his electric vehicle company would be able to make a car that only costs $25,000 within the next 3 years. Now, that's much cheaper than current Tesla's cost. He made his declaration at Tesla's much-hyped Battery Day event this past Tuesday. Musk said they'd be able to make the cars more affordable because of advances in their battery tech, which are generally the most expensive component of the car. But here's the thing. Elon Musk is notorious for making grand predictions that don't always come to fruition, and investors weren't wooed either. Battery Day was widely considered to have been a disappointment. Since the presentation on Tuesday, Tesla shares fell around 5%. That's it for After Hours, but before we go, here's one thing to watch next week. Another weekend, another looming TikTok deadline. TikTok downloads were supposed to be banned in the US last Sunday, but at the 11th hour, President Trump blessed a deal with Oracle and Walmart, so the ban was delayed by a week, and here we are again. TikTok wants it delayed again, and a federal judge asked the government to either grant the delay or defend it in court over the weekend. So today, the government filed its opposition, and it's up to the judge. Catch the latest developments in the TikTok soap opera as they break in real time by going to CNBC.com and downloading the CNBC app. We'll be back here next week in our home office on Tuesday, Thursday, and Friday with new editions of After Hours, so be sure to catch us then.